So then I discussed on this topic of the search for meaning. I talked in the first session about how we look for meaning in the world. And how we look for it. And for meaning
does not help us to gain ultimate meaning in life. Then we look at, if there is a spiritual world view, then how do we know which path to follow to gain the spiritual understanding and spiritual realization? We talked about different religions. And the third part of the discussion on the search for meaning, I talk about how the spiritual world view given in the Bhakti scriptures can help us find some meaning, make some sense of the world. So, broadly speaking, I talked earlier, remember about the causal box? If A is happening, why is A happening? We could find explanations at different levels. So to have a meaningful life, what is required? Basically, if somebody writes something, they are just squiggles on paper which don't make any sense. So no understanding comes out of it, no message is conveyed out of it. Then that we say is meaningless. The way, if a child cries or somebody just makes some noise, the difference between noise and voice is in meaning. When there is no meaning, then we say it's just making noise, you're not having a voice. Say, many people, when they say they raise their voice, but all that happens is that they raise their noise. They don't really say anything meaningful, just my slogan hearing and things like that. But how do we find meaning? That means, whatever I am doing, does it count? If I am uttering some sounds, do they mean something? If I am acting in a particular way, does it have any value? So if I think the meaning of life is to become wealthy, and then my life will be happy, that's my idea. But if I never attain any wealth, then all my efforts are useless. Or if I'm about to obtain wealth and then I die, then my life is meaningless. Worst is that I attain wealth and I still stay unhappy. Then what do I do in life? So, if meaning essentially means that our actions count, that our actions can make a difference, that our actions can contribute to making a better world, or at least making our world better. Making a better world is like we contribute to the bigger world, but at least we make our world better. So all of you are studying so that you can make your future world better. You can have a good career, a good job. You are coming here to learn spiritual knowledge so that you can make your future world better. If you have some spiritual understanding, you'll understand life's purpose. So the idea is that meaning essentially means that what we do counts. That whatever we are doing, it is not worthless. Now, a materialistic worldview says that, okay, whatever you are doing, it has meaning. But if death comes, it all becomes meaningless. So if you are lucky, death won't come before you achieve something worthwhile. But after that, it will be finished. But a spiritual worldview gives us a bigger picture of looking at things. So today I'll talk about this session I'll talk about destiny and karma and how understanding this can help us make our life meaningful. Maybe it was 4 or 5 years ago, I was flying in a plane. I was flying from one place to another. And I saw somebody at the airport reading a newspaper. And there was a picture of a cricketer. He was holding his, like, man of the match award or something. And the headline was, "I knew God was on my side." So I was intrigued. And I googled and found out what was the article. Said, "I knew God was on my side." So apparently this was an Indian player who had made a double century in a one-day match. And he was somewhere around 150 or something at that time. He had skied the ball. And that ball had gone to a fielder. And that fielder is normally supposed to be a very good fielder, never drops catches. But when that catch came, he spooned a very simple catch. And then this batsman said, when he dropped that catch, I knew God was on my side. Which is an interesting inference. Now what he meant by that is that, now the question comes up, does God take sides in the cricket match? But now what he meant over there was that in our life, there is something which is beyond our control. And that mysterious unknown, which is beyond our control, but which shapes the results of what we do, that is what is referred to as God. In everything that we do in life, our efforts matter. Like in sports, performance matters. But performance is not all that matters. Our team might do the best performance, but if halfway through the match, rains come and the match is wiped away, it's cancelled, the team may not win. One of my friends in London, he was telling me that another of his friends had come from India to watch this India-Pakistan cricket match. And at that time, there was this fear that the rains would come. So several matches have been washed off because of the rains. And the ICC policy is that if a match is not a single ball is bowled, then they refund all the tickets because you did not get anything out of it. But they will refund the tickets only to those who have bought the ticket directly from them. But what happens in these kind of matches? The tickets are sold in black. So he had bought a ticket for £2,000. £2,000 is almost like 1 lakh rupees. One ticket for one match. And he was telling me that, you know, although this friend of my friend in London was telling me that, although he's an atheist, now he's praying to God, let the rains not come. So the point is that we all understand that there is something which is beyond our control. No, actually not even 1 lakh, it's 2 lakhs. £1 is like almost $100. So it's 2 lakhs. So 2 lakhs is probably like you go to UK and come back 4 times, that which is a ticket of one, that is a 4 airplane ticket is equal to 1 cricket match ticket. It's like that. But whatever is beyond our control, that mysterious unknown, that is what is being referred to as God. So we all understand that the results of our work are not dependent on us alone. They depend on us, but not us alone. So what is that unknown? And how do we make sense of it? So I'll present this as an equation. Duty plus destiny plus duration leads to desired result. Duty is what we do and what is in our control. Destiny is that which is not in our control. Duration is the time that has to pass. So a simple example could be in farming. The farmer has to plow the land and sow the seeds. That is the duty. And the rains have to come at the right time, the right quantity. That is the destiny. And even after both have happened, then the harvesting season has to come. The duration has to pass and then the desired result is the bumper crops will come. So similarly, with respect to any activity in life, all these three have to come together. So you could say duty, going back to the earlier example, duty is the arena of order. When I do this, I get this result. But everything is not in the arena of order. Something exists outside. Now, life seems meaningless when we work very hard, but we don't get the results. How many of you had this experience that you worked very hard for something but the results didn't come to you? Any of you? Oh. Some of you have not had that experience. You're very fortunate. That's good. Actually, if you feel, I was in MIT, Massachusetts. After I talk over there, one person came, I have a question on karma. He was very worked up about it. So now most people, they have a question on karma is, why do bad things happen to good people? It's a common basis. He says, no, my question is, why do good things happen to bad people? So, the point was that, we all sometimes feel that I did so much, but I did not get the result. But if we are honest, we will also, you can also think of times when we did not do much, but still we got a lot of good results. Maybe we prepared a little bit for an exam, but what we prepared itself came in the exam. Or we did a little bit and other things fell in place. So like in cricket, if you consider sometimes the batsman is not out, but the batsman is given out. And this is bad luck, such misfortune. But overall, if you consider the career of a batsman, then sometimes the batsman is out and is given not out. Sometimes the batsman is not out and is given out. But sometimes the batsman is out and is given not out also. So in the overall, it balances out. But life does seem unfair at times, where we do something and we don't get the results. Or sometimes somebody else doesn't seem to be working and they seem to be getting so much result. So why does it happen like that? So this framework can explain it. That, now what is destiny? Destiny is basically the sum total of the karma that we have done in the past. And so we all do some karma now and have some karma in the past, both combined together to produce the result. And many times, this can seem to be simply invisible, and then we think duty will provide that it produce the desired result. Say for example, now many of you will be feeling hungry, and then you eat food, and you eat food, and you get energy by that. So what happens is, you do the act of eating food, and you get the desired result of energy, or at least satisfaction of the removal of the hunger. That's good. But suppose somebody has a very poor digestive system. Then they may eat food and that may cause them a lot of pain in the stomach, they may throw up, they may have to rush to a doctor or whatever. They may not get any energy at all. So in that case, what has happened? They're putting in the food in the body, but they're not getting energy. Something else is going on. The only time we think about our digestion is when it doesn't work. So this factor that, now some people by their, you could say, biological destiny, or more specific, if you want to be more specific, by their gastronomic destiny. Gastronomic is associated with the digestive system. They are cursed by their gastronomic destiny. So they eat and it causes so much problems to them. Now you see this in nature also. Nowadays there is this whole, obesity is considered to be like the modern untouchability. If somebody is too fat, everybody looks down on them. Everybody looks upon them. But the point is that, now, if normal causation is somebody eats a lot and they become fat. But that's not necessarily the only thing. Some people are genetically predisposed towards being obese. Some people might be that they have some thyroid issues because of which their body balloons out. There could be various factors. But normally we look at this and we assume this. There are some people, on the other hand, they treat their tongue like a conveyor belt. They eat anything, everything, and yet they remain slim and attractive and healthy. So what has happened is, they are genetically blessed. They are gastronomically blessed. So, for this result, desired result to come up, sometimes our duty might be 99% and this whole thing might be 1% only. Or sometimes our duty might be 1% and this might be 99%. If this is 1%, means what? That somebody, their body is so healthy, so sturdy, that what they eat doesn't make any difference. Their body can digest even stone. Or their body is so sickly that even a small imbalance in eating, big problem. So that means their state is not affected much by their present actions. It is all more or less their sickliness or their healthiness is largely determined by their destiny. But all these three factors are there. That exact proportion may vary from person to person. And situation to situation also. So now this idea of destiny, that I earlier talked about inequity. That there is difference. Some people are born wealthy, some people are born poor. Some people are born with outstanding memory. Some people are born with outstandingly poor memory. It's like, some people's memory is like a starfish. The starfish, it's supposed to forget everything every 3 minutes. So, how are you? After 5 minutes, how are you? Same question. So, it's like that. Now, there is definitely inequity. Now, why is this inequity there? That's because of destiny. The karma that we have done in the past, that determines the situations that we are in right now. But that doesn't mean our actions don't count at all. Our actions do count. But sometimes, the actions that we do may not bear immediate results. Like some people may start taking drugs. In America, drugs are a big epidemic. I think here also in Punjab and other places, it's quite bad. But suppose some people take drugs, and maybe the first, second time, they have such a terrible experience. They see some ghastly hallucinations, they have such painful experience. I'll never take drugs. Enough. It was horrible. Some people feel very good after taking drugs. Now, but they get hooked to it and eventually they'll feel very bad. It'll be miserable. But not everybody who takes drugs is troubled immediately by that. So, if somebody by their destiny is meant to have a reasonably healthy, well-to-do life, they might be taking drugs and ruining their life right now, but the ruination might not happen immediately. That doesn't mean their actions are not having an effect. Somebody might be working very hard and still, they are not succeeding in their lives. That doesn't mean their hard work is going in vain. Because right now, they are going through a phase of negative destiny. And while the negative phase is there, they will have to persevere. But every dutiful action that they are doing, it is contributing to creating a future positive destiny. And once this dark negative phase ends, then the positive results will start coming. So, like I said earlier, how life can seem meaningless. Somebody works very hard throughout their life to earn wealth. And just when they are about to earn wealth, they meet with an accident and they die. So all the hard work I did was all useless. Not like that. Is that by destiny they are supposed to live for a particular amount of time and they die. But whatever work they have done, it's not lost. The soul goes from this body to another body, and the activity that the soul has done will go from this body to the next body. So the purpose of life is spiritual evolution, not material accumulation. Material accumulation means I get more wealth, I get more positions, I get more degrees, I get more servants. It's accumulation. If we make that, if that is the basis of our meaning of life, I have earned this much money, that's how great I am. I've got so many people following me. That gives meaning to my life. But this can by destiny come a lot more than what we are doing. Or a destiny, even no matter what we do, it may not come out. But the most meaningful purpose for our life is spiritual evolution. Spiritual evolution means we expand our consciousness so that we learn to love God, love Krishna. That we move up the mountain from material consciousness to spiritual consciousness. Then we fulfill our life's ultimate purpose. So for us, destiny determines our situations. Destiny is like weather forecast. Weather forecast will tell us, okay, you want to go from here to, if I want to go from Delhi to, say, a couple of days later, I'm going to Mumbai from here. So the weather forecast may tell Mumbai airport is, because of rains, it's very stormy, flights are getting delayed. That's the forecast. But then it's up to me. Do I want to board the flight? And do I want to go by this flight, that flight? Or do I want to delay my journey and go a couple of days later? Whatever. That we will decide individually. So, destiny determines our situations, but destiny doesn't determine our actions. Those actions are determined by us. And now, if we look, earlier we had discussed this question about why can't materialistic worldview make sense? The materialistic worldview can't explain to us why certain things happen in a particular way to us. Why are certain people born wealthy? Why does certain people... Why does this kind of difficulty come in my life at this time? But this expanded causal box in which we consider this duty, destiny and duration together, what that means is, even if something is going wrong for me right now, I'm doing the right thing, but I'm getting all wrong results. That simply means I'm going through a dark phase in destiny. But everything in the world is temporary. And even dark phases are temporary. They'll be there for some time and then they will go after that. So what should we do? We should just persevere. When we go through dark times, those times are not like a dungeon in which we are permanently trapped. They are like a tunnel. We just keep walking, the tunnel will end and we will come out on the bright side. So this is a worldview, this is a framework which can help us to make sense of life, to bring meaning into our life. So how does the bhakti worldview help us get that sense of meaning with this framework? So we do our duty. And we have certain abilities by which we can do certain things. Those abilities we understand are given to us by God. And we use our abilities to the best of our ability. Do our best in every situation. If we do not have this understanding of destiny properly, sometimes it might work and if we are not getting any results, we might just get disheartened and give up. And there are so many people who might be talented in various fields, but they try a little bit, they don't get the result, it's not going to work. And they live as like wasted talents, unused talents. But if you understand, its destiny is there. Sometimes I might not get a lucky break. But if I have been given this ability, let me use it for good purposes. And the best purpose would be, let me use this ability to glorify the Lord, to serve the Lord, to connect with the Lord and to connect others with the Lord. Then that will uplift us spiritually, irrespective of whether we get the material results or not. And then this destiny which is there, ultimately, destiny is not malevolent. Malevolent means it's not out to hurt us. Destiny is basically reciprocal. That destiny is basically what we have done, that's what comes back to us. It's our own karma. And Krishna controls that. So for a devotee, Krishna can arrange the karma to come in such a way that helps the devotee to grow spiritually. That although the same difficulties may come in a devotee's life, but the Lord will arrange them that they'll come in a way that helps the devotee to grow. To rise up towards him. What does that mean? I'll conclude with a simple example, with an anecdotal example to illustrate this. That suppose there is a school teacher who is very strict. And if the child doesn't do any homework, then the teacher has a stick. Please on the hand. I was giving this example in Princeton University. I was giving a talk on destiny, and then one devotee immediately passed a note to me. He said, This is considered abuse here.
Don't give this example. Now, of course,
it's true that sometimes teachers can become abusive. But the idea is some amount of disciplining is required. Otherwise, the teachers fail in their duty to the children. So, I met one devotee. He said that, you know, he was voted out of his job by his students. I said, what do you mean? Do you have democracy in the classroom? He said, no, their water system is that he was a little strict kind of person. So, they have a rating system that after every course, the students will rate their teachers. And if a teacher is very strict, then all the students come together and like a group, they all downvote the teacher. And if all the students downvote the teacher, then the teacher loses that class. So it's quite interesting system. Because in one sense, you want to protect any teachers from becoming abusive. But the problem is that if there is no discipline, the students won't grow. The students won't grow. And there's a book in America, they call the America, the current generation is the dumbest generation. Dumbest generation because there is no, actually, there was a court case, right now it's going on in Harvard, that just like we have this reservations in India, in America they call it affirmative action. That means, they say that in the African Americans, they were discriminated against for many years, in the many generations. So they want to include them. They say if it's only on merit, in all the Ivy League universities, we will have only Indians and Chinese. Because Indians and Chinese are both hardworking and intelligent. But they want diversity. They want Mexicans and they want Russians and they want Africans. They want African Americans. So what they do, there was this Indian boy, he had got like 4.99 CGPA. One of the highest CGPAs in the history of his college till 12th. And he didn't get admission in Harvard. And there's another Mexican student who had like 3.7. And he got admission. So there's a whole consortium of Indian parents and Chinese parents, Asian parents basically call them. They have come and they're suing the Ivy League. They're saying, why are you discriminating against our children? Like this. But the context, the point I was making here is that discipline is required. That discipline, without discipline, things won't work. So if the students start voting against the teacher and they don't allow the teacher to be disciplined, how will the students grow? So Indian parents, they are not afraid to discipline their children. Chinese parents are not afraid to discipline their children. In fact, sometimes they are over-disciplined also. There is a book called... it's a book about Chinese mothers. They call it Tiger Mom. So the mother is like a tiger. You do this, you do that, you do that. But discipline is required. It can be over-disciplined. But if there's no discipline, then most of the well-paid jobs, Indians are the wealthiest minority in America. And that's why there's a lot of resentment in these Indians. You people, you came from another country and you're becoming wealthier than us. So of course there are Americans also well-to-do, but many Americans are not graduating at all. Because they just feel the studies too tough. Because they didn't grow up in a home where there was discipline. So the discipline required for studying is not there only. Again, it's not about all Americans, but some, a good number. So the example I was giving was this, that suppose the teacher beats the stick. And now the child has not done the homework and the mother knows that the child has not done the homework. So now the mother doesn't want the child to be beaten, but at the same time the mother doesn't want the child to become undisciplined also. So what happens? The mother gives the child a glove to wear on the hand. Nice thick glove the child wears. And then the child goes to school and says, have you done your homework? No, come here. Show your hand. Shows the hand. The teacher beats with the stick. And what happens? A loud sound comes. But the glow protects the child. The blows hit, but the blows don't hurt. So similarly, the teacher is like destiny. The strict teacher. We are like that child. And Krishna is like the mother. So sometimes destiny might hit us. But if we turn towards Krishna, Krishna gives us the glow. That glow is spiritual consciousness. If we are conscious of Krishna, if we are absorbed in Krishna, then even if there are difficulties, those difficulties won't trouble us that much. If we obsess over the difficulties, see, the more we think about our problems, the bigger the problems grow. The bigger the problems grow. It's like if you have a problem and if you have a graph, it's like this. If this is ability to solve problems, and this is time. Now if I have a problem, if I think about the problem, I shouldn't do this, I should do this. We analyze the pros and cons, our ability to solve the problem increases. But this graph doesn't keep going up. After some time it flattens. The more you think, no clarity comes. And after that, this graph starts going down. The more you think about the problem, the more the problem becomes complicated. There are some people who live in a perpetual victimhood mode. 20 years ago, 15 years ago, this person did this to me. It's 15 years ago. No, it's over. But still, the wound is there. Well, why? It's the past. Let it go behind. So if you keep thinking about our problems, they keep becoming worse. Some people say, I was confused earlier. Now, I'm not so sure. This is what happened. I'm confused about where I'm confused also. So that's the result of overthinking. So the point I'm making is that this kind of overthinking and aggravating our problems is avoided if we turn towards Krishna and take shelter of Krishna. So for us, Krishna can empower us to do our duty better. Krishna can reshape us so that when the destiny comes upon us, we can bear it better. He will give us the glow, that is Krishna consciousness. And the duration, when we go through difficult phases in life, if we have a materialistic worldview, then we think this life is the only life I have. If then when difficulties come, we feel my whole life is getting wasted. If we have a spiritual worldview, then we understand life is eternal. And even if I have a difficulty, it's not that big, it's not going to be that long. I can tolerate it. So we can go through this duration better. And in this way, even if a devotee is going through great difficulties, a devotee can, by having this big perspective that, okay, right now it's difficult, I'm doing my part, let me keep doing my part. If I can continue doing my part, the destiny is unfavorable right now, that unfavorable destiny will end and I'll be able to move forward. So, whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. Whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. So I'll summarize. I spoke on this theme of the search for meaning, the third part. I talked about how does growing spiritually help make our life meaningful. So I said, when we say meaningful life means what? That whatever we do, it counts. It has some value. If somebody makes some sounds, but it's just noise, then we say there's no meaning. So if you're making some sound, that it has some value to it, some meaning to it. So a materialistic worldview can make our life meaningless at any moment. I work hard to attain a particular position, and I die just before attaining that position. That's the meaningless life. So how can we make sense of the apparent meaninglessness of life? And how can we see our life to be meaningful? I talk about this concept of destiny, that the situations that we face in our life are determined by destiny. And that's why sometimes we might be doing our best, but we might be having unfavorable situations, so the results might not manifest. So that we often think that if I do my part, I should get the result. And in many situations it appears like this because these two might be very small, might be playing a very small role at that time. But there are other times when this can play very big roles. And we might, sometimes this might play just 1% role and just our action produces the immediate result. Sometimes this might play the 99% role and our actions just have no effect. So if we understand that destiny is what we have done in our past, that karma accumulated together, then the actions that we are doing, even if they are not producing an immediate result, that doesn't mean they are going waste. It just means that we are going through a difficult phase which will end. A dark phase is like a tunnel, not like a dungeon. And if we consider that life's purpose is not material accumulation, because that can be taken away at any moment. Life's purpose is spiritual evolution, to connect with Krishna, to develop our devotion to Krishna. And that we can do at every moment, even when destiny is favorable or unfavorable. If we have a particular ability, if destiny is favorable, the material results will come, if you use that ability well. If the destiny is unfavorable, the material results may not come. But if we are using our ability in a mood of service to Krishna, then we are connecting with Krishna. We are growing toward Krishna through that. And that itself is a successful life. And I talk about this example of the child being slapped, the child being struck with a stick, and how destiny is like the strict teacher, Krishna is like the mother, and Krishna consciousness or spiritual consciousness is like the glove. So if we put on the glove, even if destiny becomes unfavorable, still we can tolerate that storm and move on. Whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
So, can we explain the duration of it?
Okay, can I explain the duration? Yes. It's different. Everything grows at its own phase. Just like, say, if you study for an exam. Now, you might study very well, and you might have done very well also, and you're going to get a good result. But you will not know the result till the results are declared. So your endeavor is there. That's the duty. You're studying very well for the exam. And say destiny is favorable. That's good. That means, you know, you didn't fall sick just before the exam. You know, while going to the exam, while checking your paper, the examiner was not in a bad mood. Or while typing the results, the typist did not make a typing mistake. All that destiny, things could have gone wrong, they didn't go wrong. Destiny is favorable. But still, for you to benefit from that result, from the time of giving the exam to getting the results announced, the duration of it. Sometimes the duration might be less. Like say, you give some online paper, just give the exam, and immediately your score is told. Then the duration might be very less over there. So, these factors, how much they will be in each component, that can vary. But in each action, some, like in some exams, the duration might be 3 months, 6 months before you get the result. Some exams, 3 minutes. But that this is a factor which is the exact magnitude of each factor will vary. But that's also a factor which is always there. So in Sanskrit, this is called as karma, daiva, kala, and phala. So karma, daiva, and kala altogether need to follow.
Is destiny is fixed or it will be changed by our means?
Is destiny fixed or is it going to change by our actions? It depends on what you mean by destiny. If you understand destiny as the sum total of our past karma, then that is fixed. The karma that we have done, good and bad, that is already fixed. Now, if you consider destiny as how that karma comes upon us now, that means which actions, which results come upon me now. That is definitely affected by our present actions. So, a simple example to illustrate this. I said destiny is like weather forecast. So, if the weather forecast is that there's going to be stormy wind, there's going to be heavy rain, there's going to be lightning, there's going to be fog, all that together. And then I'm going to drive at that time. So now destiny determines the situation. So that there's going to be all this inclement weather that's fixed by destiny. But if the driver is drunk and the driver is driving recklessly, then the possibility of an accident is increased manifold. Now the driver is sober and is driving calmly, even then the driving will be difficult. And suppose there on top there is some oil spill or something over there. See, if the driver is driving carelessly, then a small mistake can lead to a big catastrophe. But if the driver is driving carefully, then even if there's a mistake and there is a problem, but it won't be that big. So how things happen to us means how our destiny comes upon us, that is not fixed. So our actions do count. That's very important to understand. We have a responsibility to do our best in our present situation. If we do anything less than our best, we are cheating ourselves. Now, this of course doesn't mean that everything is mutable. Just like, you know, Indians who have gone to America now, their children are born in America. So, there is a whole genre, they call it ABCD. ABCD is American-born confused Deshis. So what has happened to them is that, in fact, I have made this comment in the class and somebody told me after the class, there is a movie also by this South Indian movie. So basically what has happened is these people, they've gone from India to America, their parents went there and they were born there maybe, these children. So they want to be American, but their skin is brown, it's not white. And now they were born in a culture, which mainstream culture is westernized culture, their home culture is Indian culture. So they're confused. Now they may want to be like Americans, but their skin color is not going to change no matter what they do. So that's fixed. So there are certain things in our life which are fixed, and no matter what you do, you can't change them. But that doesn't mean everything is fixed. So destiny is fixed in the sense that whatever karma that we have done in our previous lives, that is fixed. But how and when which karma comes upon us, that is up to us. It is how we act right now. Say suppose now on a cold night, if somebody takes eats a dozen ice creams, and next the night they eat ice creams and the morning ice cream. They have terrible throat. Now, when they got this terrible throat, is it because of their past karma? Yes, past night's karma. So, now you can say that was not destined. That was just their foolishness at that time which made that happen. But it could be that somebody will say, I ate 12 ice creams and nothing happened to me. Well, you could say that, you know, maybe by your destiny you're supposed to have good throat, so nothing happened to you. But that action is foolish, and that action will have its consequences. So, what we do right now matters. Whether the effect will come immediately or later, that can vary based on situations. So, does that answer your question? Or does it confuse you more?
Yes, I will come to it. In one thing that, as you told in a skin color, if a boy is resident in America, he has a good money, and he will make a surgery to make himself white, then it is not destined.
Okay, that's a good question. Somebody is born in America and they do surgery to make their whole body white. Well, I think you are giving technology more credit than what is due. It's not that easy to change the skin color of the whole body. Even if you want to change the whole skin color of the face, it's not that easy. Plastic surgery is possible. But hypothetically, let's argue like that. Let's assume that you can gain power, sufficient technological power, by changing the whole skin color. That's fine. But then you can say that it is destiny. That it's not that everybody in America is wealthy. That's a presumption that we have. Life in America, in the Western world, is very tough. One main reason is that you just can't hire servants over there. Why? Because that they have a minimal labor law. And you have to pay something like maybe $15 per hour or $20 per hour, $25 per hour. And I was staying at one devotee's house. And he was going to his office. He says, today I'm not going to office. He says, why? He says, the plumber is going to come today. The plumber has given us time at 11:50. So the plumber came in a Mercedes. So actually there's a plumbers, they earn, plumbers, they often earn more than PhDs. And they give you a time and you have to cancel your work. My plumber is going to come now. I can't go to office today. And he actually told his boss, and his boss also understood. Yeah, plumber is coming, you can't come. So the point is that, you know, you may be very wealthy, but you cannot get people to menial work. Is not, you cannot get laborers like that. You have to do your home cleaning and your gardening and everything. That's phenomenally expensive. So life is tough everywhere. The way it is tough might vary, but it is tough. But so with respect to this point, as I said, that somebody may have money, then they can change their skin color. Assuming they can change their skin color, but at least still they need money. Not everybody has money. And medicine and health treatment is extremely expensive, as I said. So we might, by gaining a particular power, technological power or financial power or political power or whatever, we might extend our area of control. But the principle that there will be things outside of our control is always be true. And this area of control is called Kshetra. Kshetra is sphere of influence, sphere of control. So all of us have a particular Kshetra, and we can expand that Kshetra or we can contract that Kshetra. That's up to us. Say somebody is brilliant and they do a lot of hard work and they rise in their position in their company and whatever, their Kshetra increases. Somebody is born to a wealthy father and that person joins the company at a top notch, maybe like a assistant manager or something like that, assistant director. But then they are careless and they squander all the money and then they are left with a company which is bankrupt. Then what has happened? They had a big Kshetra, but they shrunk the Kshetra. They decreased the area of control. So in particular situations, we might have greater control. We might have greater control. So in the West, you might have greater control in terms of you have more AC, you have more, you can have AC easily, you can have so much technology. But there you don't have the area of control of servants. In India, even a middle class person can employ a maid servant, man servant. There even upper middle class, they find it difficult to employ people like that. So we all have certain areas in our control, certain areas not in our control. And that is determined, you could say. The specifics may vary, but the principle that destiny keeps certain things in our control and keeps certain things out of our control. That's the universe. So can we change destiny? You could say that how things have come upon us, that we can definitely change by our present actions. But the accumulation of past actions that we have done, they are there. And that stockpile has to come upon us sometime. That we can't change. Did I answer your question? Thank you. So I think we'll stop here. I know this topic has a lot of questions. How many of you have questions? It's 1, 2, 3. Sorry? Where are they? Okay, not now. So we'll continue this in a future session. It was already 1:45, and I think all of you also must be had a 3-hour dose now. So thank you for your patience. And we'll probably continue tomorrow morning. If you have any further questions, you can also note down the questions and then we can discuss based on that. Is that okay? So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Priman.